The Lord be with you.
I'm Tom Egger, president of Concordia Seminary, and it is always a joy to welcome visitors onto our beautiful campus, and especially welcoming visitors joining us here in our beautiful chapel. I also want to extend a warm welcome to those who are joining us through our live stream this afternoon. We look forward to hearing a lot of beautiful music this afternoon and participating in it as well as the congregation. The hymn festival today focuses on the hymns of Martin Luther, and of course, the body of hymnody sung in the Lutheran Church does not begin with Martin Luther. Many of the songs sung in our congregations have roots going back into the early church, even into the Old Testament, but we are grateful for the work of Luther, not only in his theology and other work in reforming the church, but also for his significant work in contributing to our hymnody. Luther's hymns give a beautiful testimony to the gospel-centered theology of the Reformation, and also Luther's emphasis on congregational singing, the voice of the congregation, has become such a part of our Lutheran church culture, part of our Lutheran church culture and heritage that we want to continue to promote and celebrate. I want to thank this afternoon a number of people. First of all, the musicians who will be serving us here today. Also, a special thanks to our Interim Associate of Music Arts, Cantor Philip Magnus, for all of his work in preparing for today. Our organist, Justin Nabach, who will be leading us in our singing this afternoon. A thank you to Dr. John Vicker, our Dean of Chapel, for his work in today's preparations. And finally, I want to thank Peter Reske for serving us this afternoon as our narrator. Before we begin our singing, please bow your heads with me in a word of prayer. Almighty God, the Apostle Paul taught us to praise you in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. We thank you this day for those who have given to your church great hymns, especially your servant Martin Luther. Grant that your church may never lack hymn writers who through their words and music proclaim your precious gospel and fill our mouths with praise to you for all your mighty deeds and goodness. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless your singing this afternoon.
There was excitement in the village that day. The balladeer was in town to sing the news. His ballads were stories of noteworthy or scandalous events set to catchy tunes. After singing, the balladeer would eagerly sell the people one-page copies of his songs for a penny or two. What sensational tidings from distant lands did he bring today? He made his way to the village inn, where he dragged a wooden bench to the middle of the room. He climbed up on the bench, cleared his throat, and started singing. A new song now shall be begun. The first line was familiar enough, something like, "Here's one you haven't heard." But the song was indeed new. Its subject was the death of two Lutheran martyrs. And its theme was praise for all that God has done. By the time the bench singer left the village, all his copies of the martyr ballad had been sold and his pockets were full. On July 1st, 1523, two Augustinian monks accused of spreading Lutheran heresies were brought before the inquisitors in Brussels. Their names were Henricus Vos and Johannes van den Eschen. Henry and John were interrogated by theologians sent from Louvain. They were defrocked, literally and figuratively, were given a written confession to sign, and finally were burned at the stake. When news of the event reached Martin Luther, he set his pen to paper and wrote this ballad, his first hymn. Not content with only a description of the events of the trial and execution, Luther tells how the ashes of the young men were flung to the heedless winds and how they scatter to all places. The ashes rise up and accuse the inquisitors. They rise up and accuse us. But these ashes also sing. They sing of how our God, through his Son, has rescued Henry and John and all of us from sin and death. The ashes go on singing. This hymn marked a bright dawning for the recovery of the Word of God. It was a new day for hymnody as well. The hymn concludes with a paraphrase of verses from the Song of Solomon. For behold, the winter is past, the rain is over and gone, the flowers appear on the earth, the time of singing has come.
They tried all their devices. The youth stood firmly like a tower and overcame each crisis. It filled the foe with raging hate to know himself defeated by these two lads and he so great. His rage flared high and heated, his plan to see them burning.
Thank you.
continue trying to say the youths with their last breath, renounce their faith when dying, and finally recanted. Thank you.
All the hymns we are singing today were published 500 years ago in 1524. That is, all except A Mighty Fortress, which first appeared around 1529. The foe who showed up five times in A New Song is back in A Mighty Fortress and now means deadly woe. But this hymn, Luther's paraphrase of Psalm 46, is meant to be one of comfort. Like the martyrs, we may lose everything, even our lives. But Jesus Christ fights for us, and Christ has won. While A Mighty Fortress starts by paraphrasing its model, Psalm 46, and then moves beyond the psalm, Luther's treatment of Psalm 130, From Depths of Woe, follows the psalm closely. Here we have sorrow over our sins, acknowledging that our best deeds must fail and that we cannot hope in our own merit. But we have comfort again, singing of God's love, God's grace, and his abundant favor. Each year, as our foreheads are marked with ashes, and we sing this hymn, the ashes also sing. The ashes sing of our mortality and death. Remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return. But the ashes also sing of the cross and how our shepherd, good and true, will free us from all sin and sorrow. The ashes go on singing. The cross is also at the center of Luther's paraphrase of Psalm 12. He is concerned here with false teachers who own no Lord and Master, with heresy and error. If we look for a battle hymn of the Reformation, a better candidate than A Mighty Fortress might be, O Lord, look down from heaven, behold. Here, as in the psalm, our God arises to bring his saving word to fight for us and to defend us. His little flock finds its salvation only in Christ, whose light beams brighter through the cross. The printers were in a hurry. They knew a book of Luther hymns would make a bestseller. And they knew other printers had the same idea. So what if the date on the title page was wrong? No matter. And why did this Nuremberg printer put the city Wittenberg on the title page? Perhaps they knew it would get more attention. Early in 1524, the first Lutheran hymnal came off the press. This hymnal came to be known as the Acht Liederbuch, German for eight hymn book. Though with its eight hymns and only 24 pages, it was barely a book. Even so, one could argue, the Western Church was changed forever. Three of the eight hymns were by Paul Spiratus, including his Salvation Unto Us Has Come. One hymn was anonymous, and four were by Martin Luther, including three psalm hymns. O Lord, look down from heaven, behold, from depths of woe, and the mouth of fools, a setting of Psalm 14. But given pride of place, the very first hymn in the very first Lutheran hymnal was Dear Christians, One and All, Rejoice. Unlike the ballad, A New Song, this hymn was intended for liturgical use. Already in 1524, a hallmark of this new hymnody by Luther and others was firmly established. In our hymns, we proclaim the wonders God has done. We proclaim to one another and to the world our lost condition and the saving deeds of Jesus Christ. In the hymn, which covers the entirety of salvation's story, Luther describes the torment of sin in a life that has become a living hell. So, God first speaks to his Son. It's time to have compassion. The Son then speaks to us, his people, and tells us in the tenderest terms, I am yours and you are mine. The foe returns, but this time Jesus himself tells us, the foe shall not divide us. And divided we are not. Life wins the victory over death. Christ's innocence bears our sin, and we are blessed forever. Congregational hymns for the church year and its festivals were a necessity, and Luther set about providing them. A few examples include Savior of the Nations Come for Advent, From Heaven Above for Christmas, and for Epiphany, To Jordan Came the Christ Our Lord. But Luther didn't have to start from scratch. He relied on an existing type of medieval folk hymn that was sung by congregations in their common language and that typically ended with an acclamation of, Lord, have mercy. Many of these vernacular folk hymns were already in use, especially for feast days. For his Easter hymn, Christ Our Lord, Who Died to Save Us, Luther used this existing model. No 10-stanza discourse here. 3 stanzas will do. Rather than complete images, the Easter themes come almost as fleeting glimpses. Christ died, he is arisen. Spotless victim, death is buried. But in stanza 3, the panorama becomes so full and complete, the poetry overflows. We view Christ holding everything in his hands, death and hell and life and glory. For the hymn, To God the Holy Spirit Let Us Pray, Luther started with a popular medieval hymn to the Holy Spirit. The first stanza, with its Lord have mercy, had already been sung by congregations for several centuries. Luther added 3 of his own stanzas that expand on the names and work of the Holy Spirit. O sweetest love, transcendent comfort when the foe shall taunt and assail us, and precious light. The medieval first stanza ends with the exiled people wending their way home as the tune stretches out with movement and longing on the word wending. In Luther's final stanza, we pray that the Holy Spirit keep us in Christ until we reach that true and longed for home. Lord, have mercy. Luther was now writing hymns in earnest, encouraging his colleagues to join the hymnic effort. At the same time, he was also refining the liturgical services of the church. The people should sing more than hymns in the service, so he provided congregational versions of liturgical music, such as the Gloria in Excelsis, All Glory Be to God Alone, and the Sanctus, Isaiah, Mighty Seer in Days of Old. His creedal hymn, We All Believe in One True God, already reflected his thoughts on the creed found in his large and small catechisms, which wouldn't be published for another 5 years. While the hymn certainly functioned in the service as a creed, it also became a catechism hymn, a vehicle for teaching the faith. The three stanzas recount and amplify Trinitarian creedal statements. The Father created earth and heaven, made us his children, and provides for all our needs. Jesus Christ, our elder brother, was born of Mary, was crucified, and was raised. And the Holy Spirit comforts us and keeps the church as we look for the resurrection of the dead. For almost 200 years, We All Believe in One True God was the hymn prescribed in Lutheran worship books more often than any other. Coming in second place was O Lord, We Praise Thee, which is still one of Luther's most popular hymns. Here, Luther adapted another medieval folk hymn and added two of his own stanzas. Christ's body, the same body that was born of Mary, carried our sins and sorrows and into death was given. Christ's blood nourishes our souls, pleads for us, and sustains us. Christ paid our debt, and peace with God once more is made. Frequently sung at the end of communion, the hymn sends us out into the world with a prayer that the Spirit would grant us that same peace. close our hymn festival today with the Nunc Dimittis, a canticle sung at the close of a day, at the close of a service, at the close of a life. Our evening rites and devotions often include this song of Simeon. Each sleep is like a little death, and death is but a slumber. We leave the Lord's table serene and confident, knowing that our eyes have seen our faithful Savior. And when our time on this earth comes to its close, we can sing, "Now I know he is my life, my friend when I am dying." At the graveside, after singing this canticle, perhaps even this very paraphrase by Martin Luther, a small sign of the cross may be made by pouring sand or earth on the casket. Even at the close, the ashes go on singing. And we go on singing. We sing of how God sent the people of the earth their great salvation. We sing of his holy, precious word in every place resounding. And we sing of Christ, the hope and saving light, and that we in him find joy and glory.